Check one, two, check two.
Good morning. All right, that's not loud enough, is it? It's loud enough? All right, I have to. So when I take this off, it should be okay later. All right. Okay, how you doing? Fine. Mario says he's fine. That means the world is fine. That's what it means. Jeez, we're actually early. Hello, everyone at home. What? What are you doing?
We're starting. The candles aren't lit.
No, we got 5 minutes. You want to light the candles? That'd be great. Thank you, Mark. I didn't notice. All of you folks out there, anybody watching from at home today, we think we've got our live streaming thing figured out. Stephen McGee came in and helped us to do that. Thank you again to Kathy today for doing our media. I will be away the next 2 weekends, so Craig Hicks will be bringing the message on the 27th. He's gonna preach. He can preach. So it'll be good to have Craig in the pulpit. And we are looking for someone for next week. And it really can be, we're trying to keep the time down. It can be 10 minutes, it can be 12 minutes, even a little shorter if you like. It can even be talking about your experiences going through this time to bring a message of hope through some of the stuff we've been through. So if you're interested, some people have said to me on several occasions they'd like to do that. If you're interested, that's fine. If we have no one, it will be a very short service. And I don't mean that as a motivation for nobody to raise their hand. There was a nice article, I don't know if you saw it or not, I'm going to mention it later, but it's on our website about the church from Suffolk County News. I don't know, we have a couple of minutes. Any announcements out there anybody would like to share? Sue? Oh, that's great. So we do have, Sue does a great job, and the people who volunteer to usher and to be liturgists. The liturgist, like for example, Craig will be bringing the message on the last Sunday of the month, but he will not be the liturgist. So if you do choose to bring the message, that just means that you do just that. You bring the message. Okay, so we've got that covered. Anything else? Anyone at home? Text us, send us a note. And who's going to ring the bell this morning this time?
Mark.
Okay. So let's take a couple of minutes. Wow, I thought we were going to be late the way I was going this morning. We're not starting yet. Well, it's only for you, so. Doing a sound check once more. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you hear me now? Who can't hear me? I know with this on, it's a little bit muffled. Is it better when that's okay?
Yeah.
So when I'm up there, I will.
Check.
Hey,
can you hear me?
Hi.
Can you hear me? I can't hear you.
Wonderful to hear the talking in the sanctuary live. Thank you all for being here in person or in cyberspace, where we say you're welcome long before you arrive. It's wonderful to be back for a third Sunday together in real time. Ray has said he's saving paper, so his sermon will not be in the bulletin today. It will be online for you to read it. I was glad to hear he put it online. And we are grateful for your keeping up with your pledges and any giving you have done during this time. It's a challenging time for churches and everybody. The Deacons Fund is pretty low, so if you can see your way clear to give a little extra to the deacons this week, we appreciate it very much. The plates, well, hi dear, the giving plates won't be passed. They are at the front and back doors, so if you can stop by there on your way, that would be very wonderful. We would be grateful. Let us commence with the bell.
Thank you.
I'm sure you join me in my gratitude to Sean for the beautiful music he brings us, especially now that he's here with us. Thank you, Sean, very much. Friends, you are invited to remain seated or to rise for this morning's call to worship. You are also invited to pray silently or gently and softly from behind your mask. Now, please join us. Our help is in the name of God, the maker of heaven and earth. The maker of heaven and earth wove it all from love, the same love we breathe and live and share. Come, let us worship together in this love. You are now invited to be seated or remain seated as we listen to Sean sing this morning's opening hymn, Come On In, from our Sing, Prayer, and Praise hymnal number 11.
Our door is always open, so won't you come on in? You are always welcome, no matter where you've been. When you see Christ in fellowship, community begins. Our door is always open, so won't you come on in? Come on in, come on in. Our door is always open, so won't you come on in? Come on in. Christ, our Savior indeed, helps us live our daily lives for the benefit of all, to keep the world in harmony, so surely is God's call. Come on in, oh come on in, our door is always open, so won't you come on in, come on.
Again, you're welcome to join us in your hearts or quietly behind your mask in the unison prayer, which is an excerpt from America Beautiful. Oh, beautiful for heroes proved in liberating strife, who more than self their country loved and mercy more than life. It is all about love. The everlasting arms of love that hold us, the love we have been given to share, it is more than life. And it is ours. Imagine that. The question always, now what do we do with such love? And for that answer, we pray together.
That's a good question. What do we do with the love we've been given? I think you know. I think each of you have in your heart a wonderful hold on that love. And you share it freely and often and with people you know and with strangers. And I'm here to remind you that you do. I'm here to remind you, to assure you that you do share and know the wondrous gift of God's love, and you can't know that unless it's been given to you. So there. So share it in all the ways you do now and the ways that we discover by being together. The answer to the question, what do we do with God's love, is all we can. Amen? Don't shout. And so, from deep in that place where the love resides and resonates and harmonizes, and when we're not quite in harmony, helps us to harmonize with ourselves and one another, from that deep place, let us sing to one another. Oh, no, we can't do that anymore. Let us offer one another a sign of harmony and peace and love that answers the question in this way. May the peace of the risen Christ be with you all. And let us turn to one another and through that heart share our own. Thank you, everyone.
Our first reading is from Romans chapter 14, verses 1 through 12. Welcome those whose faith is weak, and don't argue with them. The opinions of people range from those who believe they may eat any sort of meat to those who eat only vegetables. Those who eat everything must not despise those who abstain. The ones who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat, for God has welcomed them. Who are you to judge someone else's worker? It's for the employer to decide if the worker has succeeded or failed. And the worker will succeed, for our God has the power to make it so. One person considers one day more sacred than another. Another considers all days equally sacred, and both are equally certain of their own opinions. The person who observes special days does it for our God. Whoever eats meat does it for our God and gives thanks to God. Whoever abstains does it for our God and gives thanks to God. We don't live for ourselves, nor do we die for ourselves. Both in life and in death, we belong to Christ. How can you sit in judgment of your sisters or brothers? Or you, how can you look down on your sisters or brothers? We will all have to appear before the judgment seat of God. Our gospel reading is from Matthew, chapter 18, verses 21 through 35. Peter came up and asked Jesus, "When a sister or brother wrongs me, how many times must I forgive? 7 times? "No," Jesus replied, "not 7 times. I tell you 70 times 7, and here's why. The kingdom of heaven is like a ruler who decided to settle accounts with the royal officials. When the audit was begun, one was brought in who owed tens of millions of dollars. As the debtor had no way of paying, the ruler ordered this official to be sold, along with family and property, in payment of the debt. At this, the official bowed down in homage and said, 'I beg you, Your Highness, be patient with me, and I will pay you back in full.' Moved with pity, the ruler let the official go. and wrote off the debt. Then that same official went out and met a colleague who owed the official $20. The official seized and throttled his debtor with the demand, "Pay back what you owe me." The debtor dropped to the ground and began to plead, "Just give me time and I will pay you back in full." But the official would hear none of it, and instead had the colleague put in debtor's prison until the money was paid. When the other officials saw what had happened, they were deeply grieved and went to the ruler, reporting the entire incident. The ruler sent for the official and said, "You worthless wretch, I canceled your entire debt when you pleaded with me. Should you not have dealt mercifully with your colleague as I dealt with you?" Then in anger, the ruler handed the official over to be punished until the debt had been paid in full. Here ends our readings.
So this is the river, this is the long winding road, this is our path. Together this morning, it's what I've been saying the last couple of weeks, it's why we're here. And so I too thank Sean for the selections that bring us to our path together, and we do it because of what it says here. In some way or another, it's in remembrance of what Jesus taught. And so we come from that place. We try to come from that place. And we try to let others in the community as best as we can, near and far, know that that is who we are. That's part of being church, being community, being a congregation, to let others know there is a place where you can come. I know a place.
We could have done that, right?
And we are blessed with generally very good coverage when we go to the press, or when the press comes to us and we say, "Sure, we'll speak with you." Because we want people to know who we are. I may be doing the speaking, which is a little frightening at times, but it's about us. And this week was an example of that with an article about us and our engagement as people of faith in our local community and how that reaches out well beyond Sayville. That was part of the message. And if you haven't seen the article, it's posted online, so you can take a look at it, and I want it on our website. And I want to thank Linda Liuzzi, the reporter, and Suffolk County News, who has covered this congregation long before I arrived here. Most notably, one thing that caught my attention, which is just about 4 years ago now, when I began to interview with your pastor nominating committee, and that was a frightening group. Whoa. When I began to interview with them, it was the picture of the crosses on the front of the lawn from the cover of the newspaper that showed me just how connected Sayville Congregational United Church of Christ is to social justice, and in a way that connects that outward as well as embraces it inward from here and our hearts. And sometimes you prepare for an interview. Over time, I have learned that's a good thing to do. And when you do, at least I have frequently discovered things about myself I didn't expect in the preparation. And in this case, I discovered some things as I wrote down in my notes, some of the words and the phrases the language even that I use and the way that I think sort of came out in my notes. One of them that appeared in the article, which I was happy Linda picked up because I handed it to her, worship is about social justice and social justice is about worship. There's no diversion. Otherwise, one is not full or whole or effective. I also wrote down, she didn't write this, I don't think, which is probably good, but I also had written down, if you're not a bit angry, you're not paying attention. I never want to suggest that people should be angry, but boy, if you're not a bit angry right now, you can't be paying attention. And of course we are. And then there was something that was the core of the comments. We've said this here often, that what we do here, my comments even here, the statements we make, it's about policy, not about politics. Standing for and with others, voting, completing the census, marching, protesting, as people of faith doing those things, whatever else it might be about, it's an act of love. It's an act of love. And in that is our authority. I have referred to that a lot. And by that I mean our unshakable relationship with God is in that place of love. That's our authority to come from a place of love. It is the relationship we have with God. It is the way many of us know God in terms of. It is what we speak. It is an expression of a relationship that emanates from God, from the love of God, love of ourselves, and love of one another. It's the great commandment. Love your God with all your heart, your soul, and your might, and then love one another as yourself. Everything else is commentary to me. In November, I will celebrate my ordination, which I know some of you think took place about 70 years ago. It was only 15 years ago. I was 54 years old. And you know, I always believed in love. I didn't quite exactly know what to do with it, but I always believed in it. But as I've continued and grown and been here with you and in other settings, it's really, really turned out clearly to me that that is all that it's about. When I compose our prayers, when I read the scriptures in preparation, put them on the slides, when I share conversations with you, prepare worship, these comments, it is always with the hope that somehow it will reflect love. A love as strong as it is gentle, as loud as it is quiet, as unreachable as it is present. The primal power of all things. And that language doesn't do it justice, but it's all we have. In my relationship with the dynamic forces of God in my life, I continue to find myself more humbled, slowly less resistant, and more assured that love is as much as I am. And it encompasses all things. It involves prayer and action, being with others, and quiet time alone. And all of these things, especially being with the others part, can be a little tricky. And sometimes being with others can bring out not the best, probably the most interesting parts of the human condition that we share. And in today's first reading, Paul must have been dealing with a pretty interesting bunch. We read the words of the gospel, of the writings, to peek into the scenery behind them, The words reveal the scenery behind the words. Why is he talking about welcoming people no matter what they eat? Was this an argument over being a vegetarian or not? No. Was it an argument over who they worked for or not? No. Was it an argument over what days were sacred to one religion or one group and what days were sacred to the other? Was it an argument about that? No. And yes to all of those things. And Paul's saying, no, it's not. He makes the rather bold statement that it doesn't matter. What he's talking about is how we welcome people no matter what they eat, who they work for, or what sacred days they have or don't. He makes the rather bold statement, I think, when he says, we are not living for ourselves. And in the words that were read from today's unison prayer, America the Beautiful, it talked about sacrifice. We're not living for ourselves. Saint Francis of Assisi's prayer that many of us know and love says this in the second half, O Divine One, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, and it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. It's not about us. We are not living just for ourselves. At least not if we embrace these teachings. It's central to our teachings, which means we know who we are and we can also bring that to others even if they're not ready to hear it and just leave it for them to follow when they are. We remember that Paul was really the first of the missionaries, and he was out in a world that knew nothing about what he spoke, among people who already had traditions and foods and celebrations. Yet they were listening to Paul, and he was listening to them. And his message to them was clear. Don't divide people based on your practices. Welcome them because of God's love for you and them, and your love of God and their God, if you can. And as you understand the divine, let them understand their divine and leave all this other stuff up to God. Leave the division, leave the dividing, leave it up to God, and instead practice this love that you have been given to share, that it's not just for yourself. Just do whatever you're doing for God and don't include prejudging or judging anyone, he might have said. And for Paul, who was so caught up in the spirit to bring that message, sure contrasts with some of today's more judgmental preachers who preach that gospel of division, that gospel of prosperity, that gospel of elitism, separatism. And all of this, Paul's words and our relation to it today, takes us behind the words to what was going on, revealing the amount of courage loving and bringing that love forward into the world requires. It is not easy. And if we are reading these passages as part of our worship, as informing our social justice outreach and the other ministries, then we look for the connections. And here is the first and most fundamental of all. Seek the kinship you have with God in one another, not because of your differences, but because we need to learn how to embrace them. Do not divide because of our differences. Let them somehow bring us together, even if others aren't going to come to us. We can't stop going toward them. And as if to underscore Paul's words of this morning's reading, we don't live for ourselves, nor do we die for ourselves. Both in life and in death, we belong to Christ. How can you sit in judgment of your kin? Or how can you look down on your kin? We all have to appear before God, the same God, by whatever name you know that God. And so Matthew picks that up with Jesus' parable about mercy. And it's a well-known story. The ruler forgives a very large financial embezzlement or mismanagement of one of his officials. After that official begs and pleads and begs and begs and pleads, I'll never do it again. Please, your... And the ruler relents. Okay, go ahead. And forgives the debt. Doesn't say pay me back over time. Here's the term. Forgives the debt. And then the one who was forgiven goes out. What does he do? Somebody owes him like $20. He's having him tortured for the $20, and the word gets back to the ruler. And the ruler is ticked. And along with the disrespect of that debtor towards the ruler, along with the dismissal of those who are less than as someone that can easily should be punished for any infringement, along with the lack of mercy inherent in the gifts of God that we have all been given that this debtor showed no sign of having, and the truth, the denial of mercy, if you are a believer, is a denial of God, along with all of that, today I extract the biggest problem of all, the lack of integrity of the official that was forgiven his debt, the lies he told to get out of trouble, the persuasive petitions he came up with for forgiveness, the promises to change. None of it was true. It was just an interaction that was a transaction to get out of a problem. None of it was true. And it was that. It was the lies, the lack of integrity, the lack of authenticity, the inability to be genuine, the promises made to others that weren't true that they believed in because you made them. That, today, I extract as the greatest fault of that official. And I leave us with this. I think that what is true is loving. I think it is the first of all truths. It is at the core of worship. It is at the core of social justice. It is at the core of all there is. And it is from where our authority and our courage come. Our prayer and our action, if we choose to make it so. May it be. And so this is our time of prayer, and we're listening as well for those who are watching at home or will watch later for your prayers, and we hold them close. I want to bring sad news this morning that Greg Honorato's dad, Greg and Meg, his dad died over the weekend peacefully. He really had been sick for a very long time, and it's always sad news, but I spoke to Greg and I said, who do you think might meet him when it's his time to cross over? And Greg was sure that it was his aunt, Greg's aunt, Carol. And how that happens, I'm not sure, but I believe something expressed in those words is true. And so we know that Greg's dad, as those who have gone in our own lives, are fulfilled and living in the everlasting gods of arms. Everlasting arms of God. But the loss and the sorrow and the grieving, where we know that too. And so our arms and love around Greg and Meg and all the family. Also want to remember some petitions I've had for, in particular, children, adult children of some of you who are struggling. And you have asked to keep them private, but know that we are praying for those prayers, and God knows how to work that out, and that you're held even if it's not being spoken out loud. I want to mention my friends up in Rochester, New York. It's pretty hard to get away from the news. There's another example of another death of a person, a black person, under conditions that are still being figured out, but horrific by all accounts. Black Lives Matter. We say it in all the ways we can. We stand with others. We speak it. We put it on our signs. We pray for it. And those prayers and signs and the way we stand with others is not a diminishment of anyone else. It's a statement of justice, long overdue. And so to my friends, especially my friend Kate Kelly, who's just gone to Rochester with her two kids to serve there as a pastor, the first day found herself being asked to do much more than she expected, but what she is most capable of doing because of who she is in God's ways, things happen. So prayers for those folks, for California and the fires that, I don't know, we all know people on the West Coast here, and I've been in touch with my friends. I can't imagine. So we hold all them in our prayers. And now, please quietly take just a moment to lift your own prayers in your hearts here and at home. And we give thanks because of the privilege we have to be here in these days, in these times, to love and do what we can. And there is much to do. And what a wonderful group and congregation this is, in the ways it does and passes that on. And with those and your prayers, those thoughts and your prayers and more, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught the disciples to pray, the way you learned to pray it, saying, Creator God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
The church is one.
Lord. We are Christ's new creation by water and the word. From heaven Christ came and sought us in love to set us free. With precious blood Christ bought us for all eternity. Elect from every nation, yet one o'er all the earth, one charter of salvation, one God, one faith, one birth, one name together blessing, one holy food we share, till one hope we are pressing, at one in work and prayer. Mid toil and tribulation and tumult of our war, we wait the consummation of peace forevermore, till with a vision glorious our longing eyes are blessed, and the great church victorious shall be the church at rest. Yet we on earth have union with God the three in one, and mystic sweet communion with those whose rest is one. Oh, happy ones and holy, God give us grace that we, like them, the meek and lowly, may live eternally.
Friends, go forth in love and acts of love in all the ways you may, and may the peace of God be there to greet you and sustain you and one another as we do. Amen.
Love is all you need. coffee.